A blessed Sabbath day, brothers and sisters in Christ.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, Sister Marvi.
I would like to thank the Lord for giving me this opportunity to serve Him. It is indeed a great privilege for us to worship and glorify His name. I just want to welcome you in our Sabbath school program this morning. My part this Sabbath day is to introduce and acknowledge the participants for this morning. The opening prayer will be given to us by Brother Randy Gamble Uval, one of the Filipino teachers in Thailand. After that, we will be singing the opening hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be. But it seems he's not here. Let's see. Okay, I will do the prayer. Dear Heavenly Master, we thank Thee for giving us this another Sabbath to worship You. We are so blessed to be with each other in worshiping Your name. We ask Thee to please be with us and grant us the knowledge and understanding that we may be able to comprehend the lessons and the things that we are going to hear this Sabbath day. Thank You so much, Father, for hearing and for forgiving our sins. This all I ask in the loving name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love, at the impulse of Thy.
Let's sing together. Take my feet.
Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Always only for
sing like this. Take my life.
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 I give it once again.
We do. Take my life.
Take my
silver and my gold, not a mind.
This morning, the focus of our program is about health. And so there will be three presentations that will be discussed and presented our health professionals and experts, Sister Shaira Rodulfo, our first presenter, and kinesiologist. Our second lecturer will be Brother David Hanson Bartolomeo, physiotherapist. After that, we will be hearing about nutrition therapy and some health advice from our dear nutritional therapist and health coach, Sister Sonia Barnes.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I'm just going to share my screen quickly here. Okay, can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
All right, so the title of our health talk for today is Fall Prevention Month. So the theme that we have is we fall down, we get up. Okay, so my name is Shaira once again. I am a kinesiologist here in British Columbia. So what does a kinesiologist do? Basically, a kinesiologist help injured or able-bodied clients to get back to the things they love doing and so that they could functionally continue on what they used to do. A lot of people mistaken us from being personal trainers. We are in a way, but we cater more on the rehab side, which is more injured clients. And the length of, because we have a degree rather than personal trainers who has a certification instead. So I just want to show you some stats on our about falls. So about 20-30% falls are due to age-related injuries. So about 20-30% of it is caused by seniors. Now, most of the time, falls is due to if people has chronic pains, if they have reduced in mobility, or they had lost an independence that in a way like they cannot walk on their own, or they need some external device such as cane or walker to be able to walk. And sometimes a falling or the having a fall can lead to death. About 85% is the hospitalization of falls is caused by seniors again, and 95% of people who are hospitalized is due to either a hip fracture or any type of fracture, and about 2 billion of this healthcare cost is due to falls, and mostly about 50% of them happens at home or in whenever you're around your place, whether be it exterior or interior. So I have an activity for us guys, and I would like some participation for this one. So this is a fall risk escape room, meaning that you guys are going to tell me or identify the things that can cause a fall. So who can identify one cause of a fall? Anyone?
The purse on the floor.
Yeah. Sorry, Sister Victoria?
It looks like a purse on the floor over there.
Okay, that's like one. Okay. Who else?
The wire, I think.
The wire, perfect. Anybody else?
The stuffed toy.
The stuffed toy, yes. I need two more.
The transition between the different types of flooring.
Okay, nice, very observant. Anybody else? Last one.
Carpet.
Okay, perfect. So you guys got most of it. So first thing is the cord. So cords is a trip hazard, first of all. So we tell some of our clients who are who had fallen, when we ask them what the cause of it is, sometimes they get caught on the cords. So we try to the solution for it is sometimes is to just get a cordless phone, because sometimes it's the phone cords or even the lighting. So either than putting it in front of you, move it on the back or tape it down. Another one is the stuffed toy. Yes, the purse, everything that you can see are on the ground, which is again a trip hazard, because if someone tries to get up from the chair and then they step on it, of course that causes imbalance. Another thing is the carpet. So a lot of at different ages, actually, even I sometimes would trip if there's the carpet. So we tell people, or one solution for it is to tape down your carpets, or try to move away tape down the carpet, or have like non-slip carpets and move it away from other furnitures, or like walkway rather, that could if you're walking through this area a lot, then try to either move it back closer to the chair, or again tape it down so that you don't trip on it. So the three things that you guys didn't identify first is this guy. So it looks like a card, but it could be a side table as well. So a lot of people, most especially seniors, when they fall, you kind of need something sturdy, right? So by this being away from the chair, it's harder for the person to stand up, because there's nothing to hold on to. And even if they do fall, to be able to get up, they have to hold on to something. So furniture like a side table or a sturdy chair could help help them get up. So you want to try to make sure that you move or decide the side table closer to the chair. Another one is a blanket. So this is can also be a trip hazard. So again, when getting up, you might be caught on it. So try to keep it away from the floor. And also, most important is the lighting. So if it's too bright or too dim, it could inhibit people from seeing, especially if you do have eye issues. If it's too bright, you might not see the toy that is colored white. If it's too dim, again, at the same time, you can see the clutter around the floor. So what are the three types of or what are the three things that causes fall? So first is physical. So first thing is being inactive. If you don't exercise or you don't do any physical activity such as walking or something. So we have a saying in my field that if you don't use it, you lose it. So basically you only need it only takes about 3 to 4 weeks for the muscles to lose its strength when you don't use it. Another thing is having an improper foot care, or having long nails, or having shoes that are too high in the sole. So without having good support and not having good size on the shoes or the things that you use around the house could cause imbalance. Of course, if once you step, you would feel a pain that causes you to either lose your balance or to lose balance or stability. So another thing is having not good bone health. So that could also, if you have an existing osteoporosis, or you know you have brittle bones caused by some sort of disease. So again, if we do not exercise, we tend to lose the calcium and the strength or the density in our bones. The Second one is environmental. So we talked about it, the hazards that you see around you, such as the rugs, the doormats, cords, or even slope and uneven surfaces, right? If we don't foresee it, say when we were walking down the stairs, we miss a step. That is a very common cause of people falling. And thirdly, it's medications. Some medications causes blurred vision, drowsiness, dizziness, or it causes headaches. So most of the time when there's when we try to get up from the bed, when we get up too fast, or we had taken the medication and then we tried to go to the bathroom, something like that. So that instability will definitely cause fall. So I will go in to give you guys some tips how to prevent such things. First, in the bathroom. So a lot of people uses mats that they put in the tub. So that is also good. Sometimes though, when we try to clean underneath and then we would try to put it back, the suction don't suck right in. So we have actually, I use it in my bathtub, a non-slip sticker. So you can buy it in Home Depot or any hardware stores. It's just basically like strips, or there's different types. You can cut it in how you want the shape to be. You basically just stick it on a very dry tub or in your walk-in shower so that it serves as the a non-slip mat for your tub. Next one is grab bars. I think most people who has been working in a healthcare, or if you see it in public washrooms, there's grab bars. So you can definitely install that in your own bathroom, especially if you have seniors around or you are having a hard time getting up. Next one, if we have any spills or any moisture, just wipe it right away. In the living room, so as I mentioned before, you can opt to cordless phones, so you don't have to rush when someone is calling you. You could have it multiple places in your house and you don't have to carry the whole thing. You could just carry the device, right, and walk around when you're say cooking in the kitchen. And again, tape down some rugs or having non-slip carpets, and do not get up so quickly. So I had mentioned here before, another thing is to, when again, most of the time people get up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom. So have a few seconds, even 5 to 10 seconds, to sit on your bed first, let the blood flow, and then go to the bathroom. In the kitchen, so try to store pots and pans in easy reach places. So you could put it in a lower shelf, most especially if there's heavy items, in a lower cupboard such as this, or you have like a step ladder that has rails for kids and seniors for safety. And if you do not feel that you are safe in getting that item on a high cupboard, please ask for help. And I want to reiterate how important it is that if we do have any falls, what are the things that we can do or that is readily available? And sometimes a lot of people do not know that we have this in the community. So first is physiotherapy, and there will be someone who's going to, and the next presenter is a physiotherapist. So a lot of people don't think of going to physiotherapy right away if you experience fall or any pain in your body, basically. You have to, the first thing in mind is going to the doctor, and then the doctor writes you a prescription and gives you a medication and you think it's going to go away. So if you don't feel, or if it takes time for you to even get a appointment for your doctor, go to physio right away. You do not even need a doctor's note to access physio. If you have benefits, and a lot of us do have benefits in our work, please, please use them. Even if you just feel a nagging ache on your hip or like a wrist you feel every time you write or do something, you're feeling your wrist. Even the tiniest thing, just as simple as a back pain, go for physiotherapy. Again, you do not need a doctor's note to visit them. You could just walk into any clinic and book your appointment, and you can use your benefit. So a lot of physiotherapists do direct billing, so you don't even have to worry about submitting it to your own insurance. Next one, so kinesiology. So a lot of people do visit us for various of things. So we do just not just exercise, we do K-taping as well, such as this. So kinesiology comes in after the acute stage of any pain. So if you do come visit the physiotherapy, the physiotherapists then say, oh, it's just a weakness in the muscle. You just need to stabilize how you walk or how you properly squat or bend down at work. So then they get sent to us right away. Or you can visit the physio and then visit us at the same time. Some just goes to physio once and then they get referred to us right away. So we do, especially if there is people who has experienced strokes, we do have clients like that. So we're more in the active part, getting them back to where they were when they were injured, or even just being able to hold a cup or just helping them blow dry themselves, right? So getting that strength and initial movement so that they could accomplish something independently is our main goal in kinesiology. There's also chiropractors. So most of our clients who come visit us see chiropractors. And because the thing about chiropractors, they loosen up your joints or they align your spine, and then you need strengthening after. So then they get also referred to us, because if you visit the chiropractor at least once a week, you just keep aligning your bones, but then there's no muscles to hold them, the spine, say for example there. So you need a strengthening program to be able to maintain the treatment of the chiropractor. And podiatrists. So podiatrist again can be covered by any benefits if you do. Also, they're the ones who customize any footwear that you have. So they will give you insoles just like this, or they could give you a brace, or even compression socks, especially for people who has a job that is always standing, or people who has varicose veins, are prone to varicose veins. So the podiatrists are the ones who refers you to get whatever you need. Acupuncture. So we do in our clinic, I also work with acupuncturists. So if you are scared of needles, there is for another form, which is cupping. So they do perform cupping if the clients are not doesn't want to do needles. But basically, acupuncturists, their main focus of study is to let the they call it internal core, like yin yang, because acupuncture is based on Chinese medicine. There is also a Western version of it, which is IMS or dry needling. So if there's stagnation in your blood around the body, they're the one who helps you to have a better flow. There's also RMTs. So again, a lot of people do use RMTs. Exactly what they do, they massage the areas that are injured or that needs to loosen up for the muscles so that you are able to move better. Yeah, so I would like to leave you guys with this verse, Micah 7, verse 7 to 8. So therefore, I will look to the Lord. I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. Do not rejoice over me, my enemy, When I fall, I will arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be my light. So in terms of spiritual component, whenever we have a fall, and sometimes physically when we have, say, a hip fracture, or we're waiting for a knee replacement, sometimes we're losing hope, and that because some people do not have any successful rate when having these major surgeries. So we always just cling on to the Lord, and that we should always pray to Him and ask Him to give us strength physically, spiritually, and mentally. Thank you, guys. If you have any questions, ask away. I'd be happy to. Yes?
I have a question.
Yes, Sister Cynthia.
So thank you for that. It was a really, really excellent presentation. Thank you for pointing out all the treatment options we have when we're injured. But what would you suggest? So if you had an injury, if you fell, you injured yourself quite badly, which option would you suggest for early acute treatment? So in the earlier stages, what would you recommend that one would do?
Like right after a fall?
Yeah, after you've been injured, would you recommend waiting? Do we go straight away? Do we find someone? You know, what would you recommend? Is there a good time to wait for, or what do we do?
So, and when there's an immediate fall, of course, we try to do the acronym RICE. So RICE is rest. I forgot the C. Help me out, guys. As I think compression and then elevation. So if you had fallen, first of all, and I didn't include it in the presentation, but I will talk about it. Try to, of course, stay calm. If you are able to get up, try to get up on your strongest hand, on your elbow, and then use your stronger leg, and then hold on to something sturdy, okay? And then sit for a while. Now, immediately, if there's bruising, say if you fell on your hip, use ice right away. And sometimes, if it's really bad, I try to tell my clients to call their GP. And then most of the time the GP will say, okay, you can go for physiotherapy, because you kind of, I think, wait for one day if you cannot move at all. If you are able to move, then you could call in any physio clinic so that you can get in, get treatment right away. So initially what they will do to you is they use modalities or different devices that could subside the swelling, and that could subside some bruising, but it will still hurt. It'll take time. And then they will tell you, keep applying ice. So that's one thing. Now, if you cannot get up by yourself, try to hold, or like if you have a cane with you, or if you have anything that is close to you, make some noise so that other people can hear you. Now, if someone, you have witnessed a fall, don't try to carry the person, okay? What you want to do is to help the client to be on their elbow, just like what I said, try to get their stronger leg, and then just hold their hips so that they can help themselves up and then sit. Because if you try to pull them up or carry, most of the time, first you will injure yourself, or they could have fractured something and you're just going to aggravate it. So you want them to do it themselves. You're just there to stabilize a hip or the leg so that they are able to get themselves up. So hope that answers the question. Any other questions, guys?
No, thank you.
All right, so I will pass it along then to our second presentation, Brother David.
Greetings all. I can say happy Sabbath, because I believe it's still Sabbath in in Canada, right?
Yes.
I've been so busy today. It's been absolutely mad, you know. And one of my friends said to me, "Well, you were supposed to be resting today." That's okay. Anyway, right. I've endeavored to pull up my presentation, and it just so happens that presentation that I have, as it looks like, it's been corrupted for some strange reason. However, we do have something that we can roll with. Have I got what's the word I'm looking for? Have I got rights? Have I got rights?
Yes. you present.
Okay, presenter rights. Okay, right. So I'm going to see if I can share my screen with you. Okay, let's make sure we've got the right one here. Okay, share. All right, wonderful. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yep, we can see them.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, right. So I understand we were talking about sort of like, you know, the musculoskeletal system, and there's my sister
Shira.
I was close. was mentioning. I am in total agreement with all that has been spoken of. With regards to the bone structure, I was going to take it from a perspective of inflammation, because inflammation tends to be the basis of the manifestation of injuries when they are sustained. Now, some people would say that, oh, by the way, how long have I got? I've got 20 minutes. Is that correct? Okay. 20-minute countdown.
20 minutes. Counting down.
That helps me a little bit. Okay. Right. So, effectively, now, inflammation, some individuals will come in to see me, and they will say that they're in pain and that they have issues and that, you know, they need it to be resolved because it's going on too long. Now, it depends on the situation, the circumstance that is at hand. For some individuals, inflammation, excuse the pun, can be a pain in that it's continuing and it's not resolving. And the question is, why is it not resolving? You have scenarios such as chronic regional pain syndrome. And that's a scenario which is kind of close to what they call pseudex atrophy, which is a scenario whereby your autonomic nervous system, autonomic simply means automatic. So you have a portion of your nervous system that basically controls itself. So an example of this would be pain messages that are sent to your brain. You don't have to think about that being sent to your brain. Or you could say goose pimples that present themselves, or you could say the increasing of your heart rate. All of these things can come about, and it's your circulation. They come about predominantly automatically. So this would be based upon your autonomic nervous system. So in a situation where you have pseudex atrophy or chronic regional pain syndrome, that's a scenario whereby your autonomic system has gone haywire. So pain messages are being sent to your brain without sort of like a sensible stimulus, if that makes sense. So it might be the bedclothes that touches your hand or touches the area that's causing you pain. And that will therefore cause a huge amount of pain disproportionate to the stimulus. Does that make sense? All right. So effectively, an individual in that scenario would be fed up, to put it bluntly, of the inflammatory process that may be going on with them. However, as my sister Shiraya, let me try again, Shira?
Yes, you got it.
Okay. All right, there you go. My sister Shira was saying, you know, somebody has a fall, as a result of that fall, the inflammation that presents itself, which produces pain, is a necessity. Number one, if you damage the area, it's important for you to kind of like be still so that the healing process can kind of start beginning. And your inflammation, the inflammation that is brought about, you know, you have certain chemicals that are released into your body that cause your nerve endings to become sensitive, or the pain nerve endings to become sensitive. And when they become sensitive, they start firing pain. And then you get all sorts of nice sort of like exudate or inflammatory exudate into the area, white blood cells to mop up any debris, anything that's broken up or anything like that. And effectively, it begins what they call the healing process. So inflammation is a necessity, but then you can have inflammation that kind of continues on and continues on and continues on, whereby you need it to stop because there's no real reason for it presenting itself. Now, with regards to the slide presentation I was looking at, he was looking at inflammation, arthritis, and posture. Okay. Now, your posture is very, very important in terms of your sort of like the health of your bones. Okay. Now, does anybody know? Somebody might know. I'll just put it out there. Does anybody know how long it takes for you to have a new skeleton? Any ideas? And did anybody know that they actually have, there are certain instances where they have a new skeleton? There's a lot of silence.
The bones regenerate themselves, or how long does it take for the bones to fully replenish themselves?
Yeah.
I thought that, no, the bones would, you only get one skeleton, right?
yes, indeed, my brother, you have one skeleton. However, over a 7-year period, you get a new skeleton. Now, what you've got in your body is like, you have, the skeleton is made up of osteoblasts and osteoclasts. You have osteocytes, which are bone cells that are set in the bone marrow. Oh, not bone marrow, but in the bone, cortical bone. Okay, and that's the harder part of your long bones, as it were. Now, what happens is your osteoblasts lay down bone. Osteoclasts take up bone. Okay. So there's a balancing act that occurs between these two bone cells. And if I'll ask another question, who knows what part of their body, what part, which bone in their body, should I say, is the thickest or most dense bone in the body?
Is it your femur?
No, quite.
Foot.
Did somebody say foot?
Foot. Feet.
Feet. What part of your foot?
Toes.
You're close.
The heel.
The reason why is because it's the area that gets struck pretty much every day, provided you walk striking your heel, because some people walk on their toes, all right, or the ball of their foot. However, what you have is the vibrations that travel through the bone, because it's being struck or it's hitting the ground, the vibrations travel through the heel and obviously up the leg, okay? Now, when that vibration strikes that area, the osteoblasts are given instructions to follow the lines of most vibrations or stress lines of most vibrations, and they lay down more bone in that area. So you've heard of the terminology supply and demand, right? Well, your body works very much on that basis with bone. So why am I mentioning this? It's so important for our bone structure, for us to have good posture. Because the good posture actually helps to facilitate a reasonable and optimal positioning of our joints in our bodies. Now, as my sister Shaira was saying, you know, with regards to treatments that are given by a chiropractic, chiropractors, there you go, chiropractic activity, and possibly osteopaths, and indeed physios, and probably even indeed kinesiologists, because it's all about it, the importance of, about movements is extremely important. When you are treated for a particular problem, it's very important for you to do exercise, because the exercise helps to stabilize the joint, and it stabilizes the joints by the muscles. Now, the muscles help to reduce the amount of stress that's being exerted on a joint. Okay, so let's say, for example, you jumped into the air and you landed with your knees straight. How would that feel?
You'll feel knee pain.
Sorry, say that again?
Knee pain, because there's too much pressure on the knee.
Too much pressure.
Oh, you get jarring in your back.
Jarring in your back. Yes. I mean, it's like your back, your knees, your heels even. But what actually happens when you jump up in the air and you land, you bend your ankles, you bend your knees, you bend your hips. So what you're actually doing is you're dispersing the pressure throughout the musculature and taking the pressure away from the joints. So it helps to reduce the impacting of joints. And you'll see your muscles, in terms of posture, in terms of arthritis, in terms of, you know, say for example, you had a fall and you damaged your body, or damaged some ligaments of some sort. First and foremost, most importantly, is to try and reduce the pain. As my sister Shira was saying, you know, the rice aspect of things, rest, ice, compression, and elevation, if there's a lot of swelling presenting, because this helps to enhance the healing process. Too much swelling can cause a problem whereby organization of the swelling can occur, which means lots of protein will get laid down in the swelling, and then that can cause adhesions to the tissue. So it stops the tissue from sliding nice and gliding nicely across each other to facilitate that movement. So it's important to really try and keep the swelling, although it's needed, but too much of it and too lengthy a period can be debilitating in terms of your progress and improvement. Okay, so it effectively, when you're looking at, you know, your posture, your position in terms of your ability to move around effectively, it, number one, helps with your bone structure, it helps number two with your musculature, and it helps number three with basically your breathing aspect of things, because if your posture's wrong, it can actually impede your breathing as well. Okay, so here we have, what is inflammation? Inflammation, well, it looks quite warm. These pictures look quite warm, don't they? You know, and this is why with the rice aspect of things, you use, you know, the coolness, or you use ice to bring down the heating of the area. You get things, when you think about inflammation, think about burning, scorching, hot, swollen, painful, loss of movement, damage, poor function. All of these things come about as a result of inflammation, which can come about as a result of wear and tear, because of poor posture, because of a fall. And all of these things, we need to try and settle them down, because this makes for a painful, painful situation. Okay, all right. I like to throw a couple of texts in to help us understand about inflammation. I used to wonder, is inflammation in the Bible? Of course it is. You know, it says in Leviticus 13, verse 28, it says, "And if a bright spot stay in his place, and spread not in the skin, but it be somewhat dark, it is a rising of the burning, and the priest shall pronounce him clean, for it is an inflammation of the burning." Deuteronomy 28:22, Lord, the Lord shall smite thee with a consumption and with a fever and with an inflammation and with an extreme burning and with the sword and with the blasting and with the mildew, and they shall pursue thee until thou perish. So effectively, you know, it's just giving us an idea that, you know, inflammation, it comes with heat. Okay, it comes with heat. So this is the word inflammation in Hebrew. Scab, scar, or sore, burning, scorching. Okay. Now, these are diseases that basically have inflammation as their root. Now, for any disease to thrive, inflammation must be present. And you know, interestingly, the more acidic our bodies are, the more there is a tendency for inflammation, or should I say disease, to thrive. Now, our blood basically is maintained at a particular pH. Does anybody know what the pH of our blood should be? What the range is? Okay, so let me ask another question. What is the pH of water? Okay.
Seven.
Right. Okay. So somebody sounded as though they were going to answer the question about.
No, I said seven.
Seven. Okay, good. 7.5. Okay, right. So our blood needs to be at about 7.35 and 7.45. Verging to 7.5. Okay. So anywhere outside of that, it causes our body's reactions to not act as they should do. The more acidic the body, the less effective the reactions. The more alkaline, it will tend to work more effectively, but if it's too alkaline, it can basically make things difficult. So the body's got a balancing act to establish. And so the more effective that balancing act, the less pronounced inflammation or the potential for disease will be. But also, let's say, for example, as was being discussed earlier, you know, if you take a fall or you damage yourself in any way, you might be playing sports or something of that nature, what tends to happen, if you are more acidic, it would have a tendency to kind of impede the rate of the healing process. Let's take, for example, diabetes. Okay. Now, in diabetes, the individuals tend to be more acidic in nature. Okay. Now, I remember being involved in an operation. One of my consultant orthopedic colleagues was doing surgery. He was doing an arthroscopic surgery, which is keyhole into the shoulder. And I have to say, you know, looking at the shoulder in the camera, it was amazing to me because it looked like, you know, and this is a healthy shoulder, okay? It looked like the shoulder inside, when it was lit up, it was almost like you were inside Aladdin's cabin. Things, it's like it was sparkling. It was like it was gold and silver, and I thought I was dreaming, to be honest with you. But I thought, I was like, wow, look at how healthy that looks, you know. But then there was another surgery that we had that we went into, and this particular individual had diabetes. And when you looked at comparatively the tissues compared to the healthy tissue, that person who wasn't diabetic, it was a stark difference. You could see the vitality of the tissue had been lost. And it looked like tissue paper. It just didn't have any integrity. And so this is what diabetes can do to the body. And this is why it's so important, in particular with type 2 diabetes, that we should endeavor If we do know anybody who has it, to try and encourage them, if they're able, to do exercise, you know, to not to eat too much, sort of like, you know, combination of carbohydrates with fats and so on and so forth, which promotes diabetes and so on and so forth. But the main emphasis that we need to grasp here is that with acidic condition, it makes it harder for the tissues to heal, as is the truth with diabetes. But it just encourages the inflammatory process. Okay? So you can see these diagrams here. Which one looks inflamed to you? Would you say this one looks inflamed?
No.
Yes.
Not doesn't look very happy, does it? What about this one?
Yes. No. Experienced that before. The first one.
This one here, right?
Yes.
What about this one? Yes. Is this one okay?
No.
So this is what, you know, inflammation looks like. Okay, how about this?
Oh gosh. That's me. Very inflamed.
Mm. These two don't look very happy, do they?
Mm-mm.
Now, this is what we would call joint effusion. Yeah, these knees don't look too bad, do they? And over here, so so for this type of problem here, they would have difficulty moving the joint, right? But also, they'd have difficulty, great difficulty weight bearing on that, and the function of that would be impeded substantially. For this knee, I mean, it would be good to consider using some cold on that to try and reduce the swelling. But also, as my sister Shira was saying, KT strapping, kinesiology taping, is very, very effective. Very, very effective for bringing down the swelling in a joint of that nature. Now, sometimes an individual might have taken a fall and they may experience swelling of that nature. Now, I am very much aware and cognizant that my 20 minutes have transpired now. So who knows? We may be able to continue this another time. But it's all down to my sister Cynthia. calling on me to assist in some way. But I hope the information really has been helpful. But one thing I'd just like to leave with you, and it's this. One way to really try and keep your inflammation under control, okay, is to, as some of you may have come across it, is to use what they call black seed oil. Black seed oil is a very, very, very good. It's otherwise known as Nigella sativa, and it's very, very effective. I use it a huge amount. Well, I use it in a particular form with my patients, and the symptoms that they have experienced, or the symptoms that they've had have reduced substantially and extremely quickly. I'll give you a very quick example. I used to have issues with my gums, you know, gum disease or gingivitis. And I had a huge degree, discomfort in my, or swelling in my hard palate. And this doctor who I'm connected with, he said to me, David, just brush your teeth with the stuff, man. He's American, right? So I'm trying to put my American accent. Just brush your teeth with the stuff, man. And I was like, okay. So I did that, and I was rubbing the area with this particular solution. And within 10 minutes, the swelling decreased to nothing. Within 10 minutes. And then after that, about a few days later, the pain that was in there was gone. I haven't had trouble with it since. I mean, I obviously keep on taking the stuff, but you know, it really does help to improve inflammation and work on other issues that the body may be subjected to. A huge amount of patients have benefited from that. I could probably talk to you about that another time in terms of what it is and so on and so forth, but it's very, very, very effective. So I will stop now. I hope what I've shared with you has been kind of helpful. I'll stop sharing.
Amen. Thank you so much.
And I'm going to have to love you all and leave you because I've got to shoot. As you can see, I'm actually in my clinic at the moment because I had to drop off some food for a community who needs food for the individuals who don't get enough food and so on and so forth. And I thought, right, am I going to do this? Can't get back home. I've got to get to the clinic and then do it. So here we are. Anyway, listen, God's blessing rest on you all. And Shabbat Shalom.
Thank you, Brother David.
Thank you so much.
Sorry, that's flax seed, right? Flax seed.
He said black seed oil, black.
Black seed.
Okay. Good morning, and a happy Sabbath to you all.
Good morning, Sonia.
It's a blessing to be here. I'm Sonia Barnes-Locker, and I've been introduced nicely by Sister Marvin. Yes, great. All right, so I'll just jump right in. And thank you for the two presenters, Shari. Now, let me get this. Let me see if we can do better than David now. Sharia?
Ashira.
Ashira. Oh, dear. Right, okay. Hi, David. Sharia. Beautiful presentation. Of course, David as well, too, on the bones, you know. And so I'm here to share a little bit more. So bear with me. So I'm going to send my PowerPoint to the screen. And I'm going to take it a slightly different way. So I'm looking at the nutrition aspect of it now. And here we go. So I've actually titled mine, Knowing the Signs. Okay, Knowing the Signs. And as we in fall, you know, we know we have we have various signs that we can see around us. Okay. For those of us who drive a car, we know that on the dashboard, we have these little symbols. And when these symbols light to it, right, it says there's something going on. Get your attention going. Listen, you need to change something. Sometimes it is immediate effect. Sometimes it is, you know, in the near future, but take note of it. And so just like the leaves in the tree, green leaves, and they turn to yellow and amber, then they go brown because the tree is actually preparing itself for the next season. So as you hear today, preparing yourself in fall, how can you nurture yourself? We've looked at the various ways to help. If you have a fall, you know, the information on the bones, what happens. And it's very crucial for us to know what goes on in the body. Because when we know, then we can put protocols in place and make changes. So we live a much, much better, comfortable life. And so when we have fall and we go into winter, then of course we know how to progress there. Of course, we know that our dear sunshine vitamin, or call it a hormone, that is not readily available to us because we have longer nights and shorter days. And so we haven't got the sunshine as we would in the season just gone, which is summertime. You know, we go to the park and have, you know, socializing with our family and friends, but now it's coming home from work, and you're indoors more, not moving around that much anymore, but it's fall. Of course, we have a statistic to say back when it gets to January and March is that vitamin D deficiency spikes. And so even though vitamin D is a fat-soluble vitamin, right? So we can store some of it. But by then, by March, April, we're going to need a bit of topping up. Just like how we got the seasons, right? Our body also adapts to these changes and these seasons. And we start feeling the discomfort in the joints. As two presenters mentioned earlier about joint pains, okay? And of course, the stress of the dark. You get up in the morning to go to work, it's dark. You're coming home from work, it's dark. And you know, that gloom, doom and gloom. And I know some people, they relish the winters, they do. And, you know, but the majority of us like to be in the sun. Of course, we have decreased metabolism because the body is as active as it normally would be. Then, but the body is clever because brown fat is what the body starts storing so it can keep it warm. So, you know, sometimes you're going out to fall and you have your, ladies, you have your scarf, and men, you have your scarves on around your neck to keep your neck warm. I know for a fact, if my neck is not covered, I'll be shivering. So I must cover my neck to keep warm because all the brown fat is up in my neck and my shoulders there. Ladies, you know, you normally have your chapsticks or your lip gloss upon your lips, but you've got dry lips, right? The skin dries out. And these are the change that the body goes through in during fall. Colds and flus. If I was to say to you, what's the most common illness during this time? It's a virus, it's just going everywhere because sunshine vitamin is not around to keep things at bay, all right? And so we also have, you know, sad mood, sometimes depression as well. And people, you know, just don't be around, just thinking, okay, everything's all down, especially have lots of stresses in your life as well. It's a case of, where does it end? Stress upon stress and just thinking doom and gloom. So people actually suffer with sad disease where, you know, they get really sad and don't go out and see anyone else. And so depression sets in. But if I was to also put in the chat or to shout out which system in the body do you want to learn, hear about more in preparing yourself for this season, it's none other than the immune system, because the immune system is there to ward off the viruses and the flus and everything that comes against us during this time of the year. But of course, it would be remiss of me just to talk about the immune system. Because of course, when we say immune system, we talk about the white blood cells, the T cells, the natural cells. They're, you know, within the body to help us to fight diseases. But I call this the control tower. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the gut health, gut microbiome. Because see, because the immune system, 70% of the immune system lives in the gut. So in order to boost my immune system, I now need to look at my gut health. Because with the gut, it helps to boost the immune system. So the microbes in the gut, and these microbes, right, there are trillions of these microbes. They're on the skin, on our arms, all outside of the skin, and also on the inside. But majority of it is in the large intestines, in the intestines. They line the intestines. And they're responsible for so much that goes on in the body. So in order to boost the immune system, I need to look at my gut health as well. The immune system, the microbes, they help to break down vitamins and minerals in the body. They help to keep pathogens at bay. It's a system that is, you know, it's been studied more. There's lots more literature out there now about this gut system. In boosting the immune system, you've got to then boost the bacteria. And of course, there's lots of research recently about C19, that those people who actually recovered was because they had a strong immune system that bounced back. So there's people that are out there taking health very seriously nowadays and doing more for themselves. So that when we succumb to these illnesses and viruses, which C19 is, in my belief, is not the only one, there'll be more. But having a strong body that can help to ward off these diseases, and even if you do contract the disease or the virus, then you stand a much better chance of recovering. So there's loads of papers out there showing how important is this gut bacteria on the inside of us. But you see, we are fearfully and wonderfully made by God. And he's made us, he knows exactly different parts of the body and how they interact with each other. And that's the key to this, is that the bone health will speak to the immune system. We spoke about the bones earlier, David's presentation on the bones. But the bone and immune system, the cells are all coming from the same place, from the bone marrow. So that's a really, really close connection there. So as you go about your daily walks, you know, fall, you may have a fall, may sprain your ankle, break your leg, swelling, all that. That's all classified as inflammation. And the inflammation is what causes swelling and pain that I spoke about earlier. But then the immune system is what's going to go in there to help so that pain subsides. Now, when you have pain that's prolonging over a period of time, then of course, David was saying, what is causing this? Is it nerve pain? What's causing all that? But to quickly say that to have a healthy immune system to ward off diseases now, in this season here, we must have a healthy gut. And having a healthy gut, it means that the foods you're eating, your vegetables, your grains, your fruits, your nuts, are being digested, because we need a strong digestion for you to digest the foods, for them to be absorbed in the body, for them to be assimilated all around the body to make good use of them. So there are times though when we compromise our immune system, there's things that we do. If we're not eating regularly, we're not eating rich foods, I call it, or nutrient-dense foods, chronic stress, lack of sleep, and sleep is a big one where a lot of people say, okay, just go to bed. But individuals would find it difficult to fall asleep for one reason or another. They may abuse the body with alcohol or toxins. Let's talk about the toxins that we have in our home. These toxic products, whether it's cleaning products, whether it's things we're putting on our skin, the sedentary lifestyle, all of this here will have a negative impact on this immune system that we're trying to build during this season. So let's just quickly look at some healthy habits. And I've got some really cheap, cheap and cheerful habits to share, but I call them my tools in my toolbox. So they are remedies, but they are tools. And first one I want to remind us of, and not to underestimate this one, is sleep. Are we sleeping well? Are we having restorative sleep where the body restores in the morning? You're getting up feeling vibrant because it's the morning and you can face your day, or that you're snoozing that clock because you're not, well, first in disbelief that it's morning already because you were up for 2 or 3 hours in the night, looking at the ceiling, not falling asleep, finding out what and off the ways of the world and all the stresses that are swirling around your head, going round and round and round. Why am I not sleeping? Sleep has a close connection to the immune system. So if we think we're going to build our immune system, we need to have restful sleep during the night. Next up is fall into fitness. It's fall, okay, but we still can get up with brisk walk. Yes, it's going to be probably dark outside, and coming home in the evening, it will be dark. But just remember, in order to survive and to stay ready, to get ready for the body to be ready during this time that we're living in and in the season that we're in, we ought to exercise. If you're able to get those trainers on or to get your sneakers on and go for some brisk walk every day, it's almost like adding money to your piggy bank or adding money to your bank account. Every day you sort of pay your bills at the end of the month, sort that out, and you've got some extras to put away. Think of exercise like that. Every day you do that brisk walk, it helps the immune system. It boosts the gut microbes and it helps the immune system. And so there are times when you will come up with a cold or flu, or maybe not, because your body is so strong that it wards off these pathogens. And as I'm talking to my sisters in the room here, where they maybe the age of, and I would say from about 30 odd years old, and I think for everyone really, when it comes to the bones, bone health doesn't start when you're 45 in your perimenopause or postmenopause. It starts from a young age. So if there's anyone here in the room on Zoom listening to me, you need to be looking after your bones, you know, not in your latter years, but before. Because as the estrogen hormones diminish or decrease in the body, you're susceptible to breakage, brittle bone, osteoporosis, and all that thing going on there. So we want to engage in brisk walks, but if you can lift some weights as well, that will help you going. Next up in our toolkit is the diet. And I know diet, the foods we're eating, what's on your fork, what's on your spoon, what's in your hand, they're actually putting into your mouth. Because whatever that is, it needs to boost the microbes in the gut that will help to support the immune system. So we want foods that have a lot of fiber, fruits and vegetables. Let's have a look at the screen. Fruits and vegetables, grains and nuts. But because when we eat this way, then we get all the minerals that we need. We have all of the vitamins that we need. the antioxidants, the polyphenols, all the different colors, they do much good to our bodies. When we eat a wide variety of foods, we get the prebiotics and the probiotics. And so you may not then have to lean on a supplement. But if you're in a situation where you're not eating a wide variety, then I would then say, okay, I say to my clients, well, you need to take a supplement then to help to boost these microbes. Because these microbes, as I mentioned earlier, they do so much for us than we would ever imagine. So the foods make ensure that you're having your a variety if you're in that position that you can have a variety of foods. Next, I just want to quickly mention vitamin C. Vitamin C is a water-soluble vitamin, so we're not storing that in the body. So every day we need to have our vitamin C. And that could easily come as lemon water. Squeeze the lemon or the lime in some water and have that in the morning, first thing in the morning. But I'll mention here that kiwi fruit is very high in vitamin C. And as we prepare ourselves and as we, not just waiting for something to happen, but in our cupboards, we can have our chamomile powder. And that's also loaded with vitamin C. Where I am, I don't know if you can hear the rain, it's really pouring down, but I'll continue. So again, I'll just mention about garlic. Now garlic is antioxidants. And we want foods that are anti-inflammatory. Foods that will help these microbes in the gut and also that will help our immune system. So garlic helps to minimize bone loss. And I mentioned earlier that vitamin C also helps to increase bone density, right? But of course, garlic helps with bone loss. So we don't want to lose our bones. So we have our garlic. And there's many ways to have our garlic, which is aged garlic. You cut garlic into and put it in the oven and kind of roast and bake it. Next up, we have in our toolkit, pomegranate. Now, this is a very tart fruit, not readily a go-to fruit. But here's the thing. In the gut microbiome, amongst the gut microbiome, we have a bacteria that's called Akkermansia muciniphila. Now that microbe is responsible for all cardiovascular diseases. So whether it's obesity, it's heart disease, it's high blood pressure, it's all the weight gain, when I mentioned obesity, now, these microbes live on the inside of us. But in these particular foods, that's going to help you to grow and to flourish. So your diet then needs to be variety. So and pomegranate also gives that help, feed that bacteria. Things like chicory roots, dandelion, black seeds, leeks, all has Akkermansia, helps to feed that microbe, right? Next up in our toolkit, vitamin D. So you then gravitate or get a supplement now in the fall season or as you progress into various seasons. But if you to take a supplement, I would then say this, that no supplement works on its own. They work with synergy. When you eat a wide variety of foods, then you get all the benefits. Once it's a supplement, then you need to take another supplement because they go hand in hand, they're like their friends and relatives. So I'll mention vitamin D now, vitamin D3, preferably, to get the benefits, knowing that all the cells in the body has a receptor for attracting vitamin D. But with vitamin D, I have to mention magnesium. The magnesium is a full abundant mineral in the body. But without magnesium, vitamin D would just be floating around. It needs magnesium. And it needs calcium as well too. And as I mentioned, as David mentioned about bones, bones earlier, and that what happens sometimes with the aches and pains, whether it's in the joints, in the knees, in the back, if we're not eating a wide variety of foods, those microbes are not able to break down what we're eating, so we can get the benefits from that. So what does the body do? But we have carefully wanted to make, actually goes to the bone marrow, goes to the bones, and get all the storage from there. So the calcium is taken from there, the magnesium is taken from there,
to help with the blood so you can continue living. So when you have your aches and pains, and you're swelling, and your knee pain, and your arthritis, and osteoarthritis, what is the diet? How does the diet look? What is this person eating? So we need to get our magnesium from our bananas, or dark leafy green vegetables, our nuts, and our avocados. Next, the blood we should have in our toolkit for fall, right, is our poultice. So you may want to run for, you may sprain your ankle, or you may run for the painkiller to actually soothe, help you with the pain, or whatever it is, maybe a swelling. We want to have these in our cupboards. Be prepared at all times. Have charcoal in our cupboard, then we go to and make a poultice with the charcoal and place it on the area where there's pain. Onion makes a good poultice. It's not often talked about, but onion makes a really good one as well. You'll get the onion, cut it up, because the allicin in there helps to pull out toxins, but also to help to soothe the pain. Comfrey is a herb that's very good for pain relief and joint pains. And let me also mention about the cabbage. Now, as you can see, a lot of these are perishable stuff. So you can have onion forever in your cupboard, or the cabbage. But like the clay is good, charcoal, have them in your cupboards when you're ready for them. Make a poultice, put it on. These are natural ways of how you can relieve pain and put toxins out of your skin. Next up, in our toolkit, water. Drinking the amount of water according to your body weight, right? Drinking water every day. Taking small sips of water as opposed to gulping water down so that we can hydrate ourselves, right? Teas, what are we drinking? There's so many herbs out there. And it reminds me that the Bible says, you know, the herbs are for the healing of the nation. So we have the roots, so we have the ginger, helps to soothe the inside of the guts. And as we work with an immune system, let's remember that if we have a strong immune system, even if we walk outside tomorrow and we have a fall, we have a system that is ready to deal with the aches and pains. And the healing as well is not just to place something on the skin or, you know, but if the body is strong, the body will heal much quicker than if it is not. So I want to quickly mention, I have quite a few teas and herbs here, but in the interest of time, I'm going to go quickly now to astragalus root. Now this helps to boost immune cells in particular and to get rid of bad microbes in the digestive tract. So it's a root, of course, but it's antibacterial, it's antiviral as well. And so we have our olive leaf, anti-inflammatory, and I'm honing in or highlighting those because once you have a sprain or a swelling or something that's going on or an itch, there's inflammation there. And when it subsides within an hour or two, as David mentioned, that when he was told to rub the oil on his gums, in no time, he was pain-free. Because his gum was inflamed. But if that inflammation goes on for a day, a week, 3 months, 6 months, a year, that's now caused chronic inflammation. That's the body is inflamed. That means the blood is not doing well. The gut is not doing well. Hence, now the immune system won't do well. So when we incorporate these herbs into our daily lives, have them in our toolkits, and we call it toolkits, the remedies, the natural remedies, they are there at our fingertips and we can just reach to them. The oils, I use natural oils, of course, essential oils. And this one's called copaiba. Very good for pain. And as I'm going to wrap up now quite quickly, I just want to talk about these oils, how we can use them. Next up is eucalyptus oil. We know we can put eucalyptus oil. These oils, by the way, because I'm talking about them, they are therapeutic. It's one of these for my clients as well as myself. These ones, they are ingestible. You can take them on the inside. I won't speak of all the oils out there because I don't know the oils, but these in particular, they are taking them internally, right? So eucalyptus in some honey, and of course with some lemon juice, that's quick and easy remedy. If you start your throat feeling really itchy or you're coming down with a cold or flu this throat. Clove, to mention clove, helps with digestion. It's antimicrobial, antioxidants, right? And it helps with the gut lining as well. And they help to build better good bacteria in the gut.
Melaleuca or tea tree is another one. It's good to have these in your medicine chest or in your toolkit. I call it my toolkit area that you can always reach to. Last but not least is doTERRA or Aragona oil. Now, during the COVID, this I call the C19 period, and it's still going on now, but this one came to light a lot. A lot of people are using this, but this particular brand here, it's very hot. It's what I call a hot oil. So the thyme as well as oregano, as clove are hot because when they get to the tongue, they will burn. So in terms of how you're gonna be using them with fractionated coconut oil, of course, rubbing on the area, on the outside of the skin, but also can be taken internally as well. And that's what helps to build digestive system and break down the enzymes from our food. As I close here, I just want to remind us that as we prepare for the fall, as we come in close to end of fall into winter, we need to prepare our bodies. But we're living in a time also that the signs all around us that, hey, our savior, Jesus, is very near. So like the 10 virgins, they were preparing. But there were five who got ready. They stayed ready for his coming. And in the purpose of this talk here, I'm actually saying to my brothers and sisters here on this forum to stay focused, get ready, and to stay ready because our Savior is coming soon. Let us in the heat of or the turmoil around us that we focus on God. Because as we prepare our physical body for fall, as in the season, the signs around us that we need to stay ready. Get ready, be ready, and stay ready. For us not to lean on our own understanding, but in all our ways to acknowledge God, and He will direct our path. So not to be blinded and confused about what's happening out in our world, the wars, the rumors of wars, the famine. You know, we have instructions to say, plant your own food. Go where you need to, you know, whether it's living in a block of flats or have on your windowsill your herbs that you can reach to, or if you have the means to go out into the countryside as much as you can in preparation for what is to come. And so I just want to close here. And I thank you all for staying on. And thanking God for allowing the internet to stay up. Okay, we'll take that for granted. Is to say to you, my prayer is for you all, for us all also, to be ready for when Jesus comes, we can all go home with him. I just want to thank you again, and I'm going to close here. That if you've got any questions I'm not able to answer today, that you take a quick shot of this slide and you can always contact me and I can share more with you. Because in the interest of time, I've actually breezed through these slides, but they're in depth that I could go on and on and on. So I'm gonna stop sharing now as I hand over to, is it Marvin? Is that you?
Yeah.
Or if there's any
Marvelin.
Questions. Marvelin, thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you to all presenters. Now we'll move on to our closing prayer by Sister Jan Claire Pinera from Philippines.
Okay, let us all bow our heads, close our eyes, and place ourselves in the presence of the Lord. Our dear and loving Lord, thank you for the Sabbath day that you have given us. We give you honor and glory. Thank you, Lord, for your presence. Thank you for leading and guiding us since we started the Sabbath school program. May the things that we have learned and shared dwell in our hearts and steer us into action. I pray healing and protection over all of us, that no matter what the circumstances are, we remain steadfast, trusting your will for our lives. We ask all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Jan Claire. Thank you to all the participants. Now we'll move on to our divine hours.
So we'll have a short 8-minute intermission and then we'll go on.
Oh, yes.
Hi, Ethan. So I want you to just tell our listening audience a little bit about yourself, who you are, your background leading up to the fall or the injury that you had, and just go back as far as you feel comfortable.
Okay, so I'm Ethan Murphy.
Is there any relation?
Yeah. I'm the son of Yvette Murphy, who's on this, on this call. I am a student at Washington Venice University. I also play basketball here as well. I have, Washington Venice is located in the Tacoma Park area. It's just right outside DC. Washington, D.C., yes.
Okay.
I've been a student here for about 5 years. I got my bachelor's degree in psychology, counseling psychology.
What year was that, if you don't mind me asking? Is this for the audience to know?
In 2022.
So you graduated
in 2022.
Okay, so you started as a freshman. What year was that?
2017.
So you spent 4 years there, and this same year is the year you graduated. Okay. So, yes. What are you currently doing now?
I'm starting my master's program in business. Currently taking master's classes, and I'm playing my last year of eligibility for Washington Adventist.
So you gave us a background of how you came to Washington Adventist, how long you've been there, and that you actually have been playing basketball since your freshman year, is that correct?
Yeah, so I'll give you a bit of a backstory. So my freshman year, I came in, you know, as a freshman coming into college, it's a new experience, learning how to play college basketball at a high level, having different lessons throughout the season. Didn't really play as much my freshman year because coming in a freshman, most freshmen don't play a lot. But during the end of the season, I had started to play a lot better and get more minutes and play more. As where we wanted to be as a team, but it wasn't a failure of a season. I think, in my opinion, I don't really look at anything as a failure. It's more of just a lesson to learn how to improve, how to be better. But that during that summer, I was working hard, getting better. I got a lot stronger. I got a lot quicker, faster, better, learning about basketball, learning about the game of basketball, better teammate, better communicator. And my injury happened before my sophomore season, in practice. It was a practice injury. The floor was a bit slick the day that we were in the gym, and I slipped on the floor and had a fall. I did a bit of a split kind of thing. Was in a lot of pain. In that moment, I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know what it was. After the fact, when they carried me off the floor, I was thinking that I may not play basketball again just because of all the pain that I was in. I couldn't walk. I couldn't do anything. It was the most serious. In high school, I've had rolled ankles, sprained ankles, hurt my knee, knee pain, stuff like that. But I never had a serious injury to the point where I wasn't able to physically do anything.
At the time, you say you didn't know how serious it was. And just for the audience sake, can you tell us how tall you are and pretty much how much you weighed around that time?
Around that time, I think I was, I'm about 6'3", 6'4". At the time, I think I weighed about 187, 188, maybe just pushing 190.
So would you say that you were at your prime, like that was the best weight, that was the best, you know, you were at your optimal, were you?
Yeah, I would say I was at my optimal in terms of physically because I had never experienced any major injuries And that summer I had done so much weightlifting and cardio and training that I was probably, yes, probably at peak performance at that time.
Okay. Yeah. So you're saying at this moment you didn't know how bad the injury was. So talk about your feelings and emotions. You know, what were they at the time?
So at the time I was just feeling kind of helpless because I was very invested in this next coming up season. With all the work that I put in during the summer, I was invested and I really wanted to help the team win and be a part of the team. So I was emotional and upset about it. At a time studying psychology, I think it did benefit me. I wouldn't say it was a huge benefit, but it did benefit me in a way where it allowed me to put myself in a mind frame where I didn't let the negative totally put me into a depressive state. In high school, I think I did experience some depression, and coming out of that, I knew what type of mindset can put you in a depressive state, and it comes with a lot of negative thoughts, negative emotions, negative actions, and a lot of sitting around and
feeling sorry for yourself.
Feeling sorry for yourself and having a lot of negative emotions and a lot of negative thoughts, because I'm a true believer that, you know, whatever you think is going to come out into your actions or the way that you carry yourself. So
can I ask you about that? Can you stand that thought? So you say a lot of what you think can come out in your actions, and like you said, we're being transparent. What were some of the things that maybe happened during that time that you know, maybe you wouldn't want to talk about in public, but you think it would be beneficial for somebody else to hear that you were, you know, coming from a background with some depression and then it feeding into how you were feeling at the time. And then, you know, what was the outcome of that?
Oh yeah. So, I mean, I just tried to look at the situation as a cup half full kind of thing. So I can say, okay, this, you know, I have an injury right now, but once I get back from this injury, this gives me more time to get better as a player and to get better mentally, as a man, to build my mental strength. This is a moment where God may be testing me to see if I, not necessarily testing me, but giving me a trial to strengthen me for the things that I pray for, the achievements that I want to achieve, because I think that when you pray to God for something, if it's within his will or if it's within something that he wants for your future, he's going to do whatever he needs to do to build you up to that point, so that when you get to that point, you're ready for whatever blessing that you're meant to receive. So that's what I looked at it as. I looked at it as, okay, this is not a loss, not a failure. It's a lesson for me. This is a opportunity for me to excel and opportunity for me to get to.
You're muted, Sister Cynthia.
Thank you. Let's just bow our heads for prayer. For the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence. Let all the world keep silence before him. Father, we are grateful that we can be here in worship today. Thank you for everything that you have given to us. Thank you that we can share this time together as a church family. May we be blessed by everything that we hear and that we experience moving forward, and blessed by everything we've heard until now. Bless us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where those abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. So, Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I abound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me out. For faith has caught a joyful sound, the song of saints on higher. So, Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I abound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. So, Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land. plant my feet on higher ground. I want my tomorrow.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, Richmond Church. I won't hear you all say good morning, but it's wonderful for us to be here together this morning on Health Emphasis Day. I hope you've been blessed so far by everything that's transpired in the Sabbath School program. I want to welcome all of you. I just want to give a very special welcome to our speakers. I know that, I think Sonia is still here with us. Sonia, thank you so much for being here, for sharing that really, really important and information with us. I was truly blessed by that, and I've learned from it. And I want to thank Shira so much for leading off with the presentation. Shira, thank you for your expertise and the knowledge that you shared with us this morning, and also for David, who had to run away. It's very it's much later here. It's about 7:30 in the evening. So welcome again. Welcome to all of those who are on this platform with us. Thank you for being here. Without you, this would be a pointless exercise. The video that we watched during the intermission was my friend Yvette and her son Ethan, who wanted to share Ethan's recovery story, which fitted in quite nicely with our theme for the day. Unfortunately, we didn't get to listen to it all, but if you want to, the link has been added into the chat, so you can take it. It's on YouTube, and you can finish listening to it there. So I'm just going to leave give a few announcements for today. So first of all, I'm just wanting to remind you that November, if you know anyone who would like to go to a Christian private school, if you have children yourselves who want to go to a Christian private school, Deer Lake, or a Christian school, I should say, Deer Lake is open during this month of November. And so you can contact them at dearlakeschool.ca. It's in the online bulletin if you're interested, or you know anyone is interested in sending their children to that school. So just a reminder to all of you that are members on the platform that 26th of November, that's next week, Sabbath, I believe, that business meeting will take place at our new location. It's really wonderful that we've started to use that facility. It's not where we want it to be, but it will get there by God's grace. So next week, business meeting is there. We're inviting all members to attend. The meeting will start at 6 o'clock. We're asking that everyone shows up at least 15 minutes early, get to the venue, because I think you probably only have an hour there. So we want to make sure that the time is used very efficiently. So please put that in your diary for November the 26th. December the 17th, it's Richmond's SDA Youth Day. Please support them as always. And December the 24th, it will be communion. So thank you. Just a little bit on the church renovation. Darcy, do you want to make a mention on that quickly? Or I can mention it briefly, that we have been waiting for permits to start the renovation in the church. We've just had some feedback, so our initial application has been denied, so due to some plumbing issues. So some changes are being made and will be made. So let's just continue to pray about that, because, you know, when we go through a process like this, there is always hiccups that take place, but every delay is always just in God's time. So let's not fret. Let's just continue to work towards what we have. And we know that in time, God will give us a space that will be beautiful for us to worship in and for us to glorify his name. So I think that's all the announcements for today. Just to remember that, you know, there are prayer lines for you to check into. So please continue to check in for prayer that takes place, and to check in for Wednesday prayer and Friday prayer. Okay, so at this point, we are going to have our offertory by Marvelyn, followed by intercessory prayer by Sister Yolanda. Thank you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone.
Sabbath.
Our local church budget, regularity calls for regularity. In Lamentation, chapter 3, verses 22 to 23, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. We worship God through regular giving in response to the abundance and regularity of his care. While going through trials, griefs, and humiliations, the prophet Jeremiah uses the plural form to speak about God's compassion and mercies. He was the recipient of God's covenant, love, grace, goodness, kindness, compassion, and much more. Besides being multiplied, God's manifestation amid Jeremiah's crisis was daily and regular, not occasional. He did not have to choose between a huge blessing once in a while or daily miracles. God provided for both. Israel responded to God's regularity by adopting a regular pattern of worship and giving. Numbers 28 and 29 report about regularity in worship and giving to God. The Israelites were worshiping daily, weekly, monthly, and during all annual festivals. Concerning their offerings, they brought two lambs a year old without defect as a regular burnt offering each day. It found in Numbers 28, verse 3. Interestingly, what they brought during the weekly, monthly, and annual festivals were besides or in addition to the regular burnt offering. During the Festival of Tabernacles, they offered the largest number of special offerings, but there are eight mentions in the text, one for each day of the festival, that it was in addition to the regular daily offerings. It found in Numbers 29, verses 12 to 38. The above example tells us that the best practice is not to be a worshiper only during Easter week, the Christmas season, or special Sabbaths. A God who manifests himself continually and regularly expects the same pattern of worship from his children. How does this principle that translate into our giving practice? It is always a joy to participate in special offerings supporting some goods, projects, or ministries. However, it is appropriate that these occasional gifts and donations are besides and in addition to our regular offerings. The starting point for such practice is to decide in advance the proportion, a percentage of our income to be dedicated to regular offerings. Now let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much, Lord, that you can satisfy our desire and need. Your word says that we should give honor to you with the first fruits of our wealth. Lord, please accept our tithes and offerings as a gift of worship to you. Multiply what we give for the effective road of your kingdom. May Christ dwell in our hearts through faith so that we being rooted and grounded with love. May we have the strength to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. May we be filled with all the fullness of God. This I pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Let's pray. Almighty Father in heaven, the Most High, we heartily give you thanks on this blessed Sabbath day. This is the day for us to glorify you, to praise you, and give the most of our time with you, our Heavenly Father. We gathered here together, your humble servants, through your kindness and love for us. We praise and thank you for the greatest wonder of technology and lead us the capability to reach out others through the platform, service, and live stream, that we are able to channel our voices, our hearts, and unite as one to praise you, glorify you, in your name, our Lord Almighty. We thank you as well for your endless protection and guidance to us, all the blessings and your love in our life. Thank you to all the goodness and love through many times. We committed our grievous faults and shortcomings. We never neglect and leave us. That you keep our guidance and protections to us in all our trials and challenges in life. You shield us with love and forgiveness in our sins. You are with us in the most different time in sickness and in health. You never leave us nor neglect us, but you keep and protect us with your loving arms and heart. At this hour, we ask your mercy to keep your guidance and receive your promise to have eternal life, but to keep and hold to our faith and believe until you come and to fulfill your promise of life everlasting. May each and every one of us, together with our loved ones, receive the promise place in heaven where there's no more sickness, no worries, no tears, no pain and suffering, and above all, there's no more death. We pray graciously that the spokesperson in this very hour, Pastor Davis, be enlightened by the power of Holy Spirit, that all the messages and lessons delivered be understood and felt deep in our heart. Bless the pastor and his family with love, the shower with good health, protection, and abundantly blessings. We bring over to you Brother Jin and his solemn time. For whatever he suffers in life, financially, physically, mentally, and spiritually, surpass all the sufferings and trials in life. We ask you, Lord, to clean our hearts and the thoughts that you want our Lord to receive and dwell in our hearts, to forgive our sins. And all of this we pray in your sweet and precious name, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Sister Yoli, thank you so much for your beautiful and heartfelt prayer. God sees and he knows your heart. He knows what you feel, and he knows everything about us. He knows about the person that you're praying for, and he sees our needs. He knows what we need, and we pray that God will answer according to him.
Thank you, Sister Victoria. This sister's in my sister in just hospital right now. That's why I'm just praying for everybody who's been sick today.
So I ask that everybody, we've heard Sister Yoli's prayer, that we continue to pray for her sister, and that we continue to pray for, and keep in mind, if we can't even remember all the names, what's the name of your sister, Sister Yoli?
Sister Josie is in ICU right now. She's in the Philippines. Josie.
Josie is our sister. So let us pray for Josie and for the family, and let us pray for all the people that have been on her list this morning. Thank you for sharing with us, Sister Yoli. That's what we're here for, and we pray that we can be a voice that's lifted up so that God can hear our prayers today.
Thank you, Sister Cynthia.
Amen. All right, so this time we are going to be given the scripture by my favorite scripture reader, Shem. It's been a long time since I've seen you, so please read today's scripture for us.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath, Shem. It's good to see you.
Our scripture reading today is found in 2 Kings, chapter 1. Verse 2-6, and I read. Now, Ahaziah had fallen through the lattice of his upper room in Samaria and injured himself. So he sent messengers saying to them, go and consult to Baal Zebub, god of Ekron, to see how to recover from this injury. But the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, go up and meet the messengers of the king of Samaria and ask them, is it because there is no God in Israel that you are going up to consult Baal Zebub, the god of Ekron? Therefore, this is what the Lord says. You will not leave the bed you are lying on. You will certainly die. So Elijah went. When the messengers returned to the king, he asked them, why have you come back? God came to meet us. They replied, and he said to us, go back to the king who sent you and tell him, this is what the Lord says. Is it because there is no God in Israel that you are sending messengers to consult Baal Zebub, the god of Ekron? Therefore, you will not leave the bed you are lying on. You will certainly die. May the God bless us with these words.
Amen. Thank you, Shem. I hope that you'll be getting better soon. Thank you for reading that for us. Challenging scripture. So this morning, everyone, thank you again. This is our health emphasis day. And the title of our day has been We Fall Down, But We Get Up. So when we came together as a health committee, Shira said, oh, you know, this November is falls month. So why don't we do about falls? And so I was thinking, how can we get falls into our health emphasis day? But I think, so once we decided on how we were going to go forward with it, I think all our presenters have done an excellent job. Have you gained something from this morning? Well, I hope that you have. I know it's hard to answer back, but I'm praying that you have, because I certainly have. And it's amazing how we can look at every subject and we can put God in it. So we fall down due to our frailties, our weaknesses, but God can pick us up. So our speaker for the morning to bring all this together for us and everything that has gone on before is no other than my brother, Pastor Sam Davis. Sam is no stranger to some of us here on this platform, certainly not to my sister, but to some of you, he will be new. Sam has been a pastor ever since he was a young man. And you know, he's had his own journey with health and wellness, and being a very active and very busy, very much a workaholic, my brother, I think, as many pastors are. You know, he had a lot of health struggles and health issues. A number of years ago, he came to Canada in order to do a health, to visit a health center. And that visit to that health center changed his life. And as a result of that, he went on to study naturopathy and passed his doctorate in, I think, 2018. So Sam is rather an inspiration to me, because he's not afraid to go for what he thinks is right and what he knows has been good for him. So Sam has changed a lot in his life, and he continues to be an excellent minister. I say that with no bias. Well, he is a retired minister, let's get that right, but he continues to preach all over the country. He's invited to preach in so many different places. And although he lives in Spain, he comes back to England very frequently in order to do his ministerial work and to do presentations both on health and both in the gospel. So we know that the gospel and the word of God, I mean, the gospel and health ministry go hand in hand together. We really cannot have one without the other. And so Sam, we welcome you to our Richmond Church platform. We look forward to listening to you. We know we will be blessed. But before you speak, I've chosen a song for this subject that I think really sums up what we are going to do today. The Potter. So I ask you to listen carefully to the words of this song and to be blessed by it. And after it, we will hear from Pastor Sam.
One day I saw a potter and some clay. He molded it, fashioned it, and caused it to obey. And soon he had a vessel he could use. It held his food, it brought him life. No water he would lose. But then I heard the vessel slipped and fell. It's broken now, no one knows how to put it back again. Oh, my life was like that vessel made of clay. It fell apart in my broken heart. Knew I'd always go astray. But Jesus made my vessel. Vessel over, Jesus made my vessel over. Lord, you made this vessel over again. And now I know his spirit lives in me. We're closer now, I don't know how. He saw what I could be. And if you'd seen my life in pieces on the floor, I wept inside, no place to hide, till Jesus said there's more. And he
excellent. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. I am delighted to be with you again, Richmond. I think this is probably the third or fourth time that I'm appearing with you there in Richmond. Just want to thank you, Cynthia, for that wonderful introduction, and your check will be in the post. It's just so good to be sharing this with you, and I've really enjoyed all the other presentations thus far. We Fall Down is your title. We fall down, but we get up. And I'm going to be running with that same theme. I have not changed the title of my presentation is going to be just the same. So let me get that on onto get that onto the screen. Excellent. So let's just bow our heads as we pray. Father in heaven, we just want to thank you so much for your goodness. We thank you for your love. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful opportunity we have of sharing this together. We invite your presence to be with us, and may your will, Father God, be done in our lives. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank the young man, Shem. His name seemed to be spelt differently, Cynthia, but for reading that scripture reading so very well. We fall down, but we get up. Now, Ahaziah fell through the lattice of his upper room in Samaria and was injured. So he sent messengers and said to them, go inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron, whether I shall recover of this injury. And, you know, the Bible doesn't tell us what Ahaziah was doing on the lattice of the building. It doesn't tell us why he was up there on the roof at all. And one would think that he would have done his risk assessment. You know, you don't go walking on spaces like that without making sure that you're safe. But whatever the reason, Ahaziah fell down and was injured. And, you know, falling down is very much a part of life. I don't think anybody can say, well, I've never fallen down, I've never injured myself. In fact, one of my sisters on this platform had an accident, really, where she fell. And all of us go through that experience of falling down. But the truth is, you fall down, but it's important that we get up. You know, if you fall down and stay down, then clearly there is something very wrong. Falling down is very much a part of our experience. I've had that experience where I've fallen off a bike. This past summer, we had a family picnic, and the family picnic, we went to the park, and the grandchildren are there. And one of my grandsons, he is really very much a young man who has very little fear. And he was actually with Cynthia this particular day, and he had his bike and he just took off downhill. And I was watching and I could see him going faster and faster. And then the handlebars began to wobble, and I thought, oh no. And sure enough, over the handlebars, he went he couldn't handle the speed. And there was a lot of crying, a lot of tears, but he got up. You know, you fall down, but it's so important that we get up. And notice this, Proverbs chapter 24 and verse 16, for a just man falls seven times and rises up again, but the wicked fall into mischief. And so the Bible tells us that Ahaziah had fallen through the lattice roof of the building, and Ahaziah was now seeking to get up. And there's nothing wrong with falling, nothing wrong at all. But it's so important the how we're going to get up, you know. And Ahaziah, the Bible tells us, was seeking to get up. Notice the last part of the text. It says, but the wicked shall fall into mischief. And that's exactly what happened to Ahaziah in seeking to rise up. Ahaziah chose to use the wrong protocol. We listened to Sonia this morning as she was talking to us about the various natural protocols that we can use to get better. And Ahaziah chose the wrong protocol. Psalm chapter 135 verse 15 to 18 tells us that the idols of the nations are but silver and gold, the work of man's hands. They have mouths, but they do not speak. They have eyes, but they do not see. They have ears, but they do not hear. Nor is there any breath at all in their mouths. Those who make them will be like them. Yes, everyone who trusts in them. And so why would you choose to go to a dead god? And so in trying to get up Ahaziah used the wrong protocol. He sent messengers to a dead god. Go inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron, a god who could not hear, a god who could not see, a god who was totally ineffective. And as we come together today, I want to ask the question, could it be that in our fall into sickness, we try to get up, we also find ourselves using the wrong protocol, going down, just like Ahaziah sent his servants down to Ekron to find out from a totally useless god? Could it be we find ourselves in seeking to rise, in seeking to get up after we have fallen into sickness? I believe that everybody on this platform will be able to put their hands up and say, yes, I have been sick, you know, because that is part of life. We all get sick, but it's the how do we seek to get up? How do we seek to rise up? And so the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, go up to meet the messengers of the king of Samaria and say to them, is it because there is no God in Israel that you're going to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? There was a God in Israel, and God was offended by the actions of King Ahaziah. Ahaziah was aware of the 3 years of famine that was brought about because of the actions of his father. He was aware of the confrontation with the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel, where Elijah and the God of heaven won through in that confrontation. He was aware of the sins of his father. He was aware of God's reproof to the house of Ahab and to Jezebel. And so Ahaziah's actions was an insult to God. The God of heaven, the living God, Ahaziah ignores him and sends and asks a dead God, a God who cannot hear, a God who cannot respond, a God who has no hands, no eyes or anything. Am I going to get up from this bed? And so God found this very, very offensive. And so, beloved, every one of us will fall sick. We will fall into sickness because that's what happens to us. That's part of our experience. But what is going on? What is going to Ekron? What does it mean to go down to Ekron as far as this presentation is concerned? And so I've likened Ekron representing a false system of healing that does not provide a true cure. God wants every one of us to prosper and be in health. And so when we fall into sickness and we rise up, we want to be able to use protocols that are going to enhance the quality of our health. And I want you to notice this quotation from the Spirit of Prophecy. Drug medication, as it is generally practiced, is a curse. Educate away from drugs. Use them less and less and depend more and more upon hygienic agencies. Then nature will respond to God's physicians. Pure air, pure water, proper exercise, and a clear conscience. Amen. So those who persist in the use of tea, coffee, and flesh meat will feel the need of drugs, but many might recover without one grain of medicine if they would obey the laws of health. And I'm going to expand this statement a little. Those who persist in the use of unhealthy diets, will feel the needs of drugs, but many might recover without one grain. So if you're one grain of medicine, so if you are pursuing a healthy lifestyle, then you will be drawn to a healthier protocol. Notice God says to us, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered. And so God challenges us. And this challenge saying, is there no balm in Gilead? And this morning as I come to you, I'm saying, yes, there is a balm in Gilead. Yes, God has a better way for us to get healing and recovery. And it is not by going down to Ekron. Notice what drug medication accomplishes. It masks the difficulty. It masks the problem. So it does not really deal with the issue. The drugs do not eliminate the problem. They contaminate the internal environment. So just adding to the problem rather than curing the problem. They create a dependency on the part of the patient. So what does that mean? It means that, we go to our doctor when we fall into sickness and we're seeking to get up, as we do, go to my doctor and I say, doc, just give me something to fix me up. I just need a tablet so that I can carry on with my life. I need something quick. We're looking for a quick fix. Just give me a tablet. Give me some medicine that will help me to feel better so that I can go back to work. But notice what drugs do. They also erase valuable clues as to the real source of the problem. And beloved, so I'm suggesting to you this morning that in our desire to get up, we are going down to Ekron. And I'm not saying that we should not go to our doctors, beloved, because that doctors are important. They are important in helping us to find out what's going on. But what happens after you've been to your doctor is entirely your choice. You know, and so drug medication is not what God has in mind for us. Just have a look at this statement. Over-the-counter drugs are a major component of the healthcare industry, both from a financial and medical perspective. Over-the-counter drugs are important because they are the force behind health and health maintenance outside hospitals and healthcare facilities and play a critical role in patient compliance. And so the whole world has bought into this philosophy. I just need a pill, I need a tablet, I need an injection, I need something. But this is the drug industry speaking and saying that it plays a critical role in patient compliance. With the recent trend of increasing the number of medications available over the counter, the role of OTC drugs will only continue to expand and evolve. And this is from TechNavio blog. According to analysts at TechNavio, the global over-the-counter drug market, which was valued at $120 billion in 2015, will reach There are individuals when they get up in the morning, in order to begin their day, they are using 5, 6, 7 tablets just to get through the day. That is never God's, was never God's intention for us in our desire to rise up, in our desire to get better. It's not God's intention that we should be putting these poisonous chemicals into our bodies as we seek to get well. So look at these statistics here is from the UK, and this is what we are spending in the UK on over-the-counter medication. Oral lesions, 40.5 million. Adult analgesics, 364.8 million. Topical analgesics, 111 million. Hay fever remedies, 125 million. Sleeping aids, 43.1 million. And so we are focused and we have been conditioned into believing that when we fall sick and we're trying to get up, that the only way to go is to go down to Ekron and to use drug medication. And this evening, this morning, I want to say to you that there is another way. God has something better in mind for us. By the use of poisonous drugs, many bring upon themselves lifelong illness, and many lives are lost that might be saved by the use of natural methods of healing. The poisons contained in many so-called remedies create habits and appetites that may mean ruin to both soul and body. This is from the book Ministry of Healing, page 127. Elvis Presley officially died of a heart attack in 1977. And I remember the shock for me personally when I heard the news that Elvis had died, because he was not that old. But the state board medical examiners found that his physician had prescribed some 12,000 pills, tranquilizers, stimulants, sedatives, and painkillers for him in the last 18 months prior to his death. Beloved, just think about this. If Elvis had tried good nutrition, if he had tried exercise and water, if he had tried sunlight, if he had tried temperance and fresh air, just the natural remedies, Elvis would still be alive today. The same thing for Michael Jackson. Propofol is a fast-acting hospital sedative administered intravenously and used before anesthetics. It was first used widely in the late 1980s, but Jackson was using this stuff. Lorazepam. Conrad Murray told police in 2009 that he gave Michael Jackson other drugs known as benzodiazepines, which are also used as sleep aids. So Jackson was struggling to sleep. He was struggling. In fact, he was struggling just to live. And so he was taking all of these compounds, all these poisonous drugs. Diazepam is better known as Valium. Lidocaine is a local anesthetic and is sometimes used to treat skin inflammations. Ephedrine was also found in Michael Jackson's body. It's primarily used as an appetite suppressant and stimulant. His body was riddled with all of these poisonous substances. It's no wonder that his heart gave out. So the doctor was administering these things, but Jackson also administered them himself on his own without any medical supervision. These things are not what God has in mind for us. Matthew chapter 7 and verse 13, I want you to notice this text and this little caricature here. Enter in through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction, and there are many who enter through it. Now, have a look at this: toxic pills and surgery. And then look at the other side, lifestyle change, and the queue's empty. It's empty because everybody feels they have to go down to Ekron in their desire to get up, in their desire to find healing and wellness. We go in that lane where we get cut. I had a friend recently, I was talking to her, and she said, I'm going to get my gallbladder taken out. And I said, well, no, you don't have to do that. There are individuals who can help you. You don't have to get your gallbladder cut out. Here is a number of a friend that you can call, and she will help you. And do you know that lady never made that phone call? She chose rather to go and get her gallbladder taken out. What a shame. What a tragedy. What a tragedy when you can get up and live in health using holistic methods. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leads to life, and few there be that find it. So a friend of mine, Dr. Chidi, said that during the pandemic, there were some individuals that were his patients, and he said to them, listen, you have underlying circumstances, and I can help you. You know, they had diabetes, high blood pressure, obesity, and he said, I can help you navigate your way through the pandemic. All you need to do is to make some lifestyle changes. And Dr. Chidi told me that these patients said to him, you know what, doc, I'm quite happy with my lifestyle. Just give me a pill. Just give me a pill. Just hook me up with a pill so that I can get better. And we are saying, beloved, that toxic drugs is not the answer. That's not God's way for us. And yet, as Seventh-day Adventist Christians, I have to say, sadly, that we are also conditioned into taking the pills. I want you to notice the most commonly used types of prescription drugs by Canadian adults aged 40 to 59 were analgesics. These are painkillers, 10.4%, antidepressants, 8.8%. Dr. Neil Nedley tells us that when you are feeling depressed, he says nutrition first, nutrition and lifestyle first. Amazing. Lipid-lowering drugs, 8.1%. Proton pump inhibitors for reducing stomach acid, 7.2%. And anti-diabetic agents, 6.6%. And beloved, you know, what a tragedy. Because if the stomach, you know, if you're finding that you're having acid reflux and all of this, the last thing that you want to do is to be taking proton pump inhibitors to reduce the stomach acid, because you need the stomach acid for digesting the food. So what we need to do is to get back to the cause. Why are you experiencing acid reflux? Are you eating late at night and going to sleep on a full stomach? What are the reasons? What are the causes? And once you know the cause, then you can make the lifestyle change. You can use natural remedies. But what we have become accustomed to doing is taking tablets, taking these inhibitors. And because you need the acid for digestion, when you reduce the amount of acid that the stomach is producing, it means that you are not digesting your food as effectively. It stays longer in the stomach, and there is the likelihood of colon cancer. We don't want that. We want to look at natural ways of dealing with the problem. So falling is an integral part of life, but so is getting up. And so for the rest of this preparation, I want to talk to you about preparing for the fall years. You know, these are, Sonia was very good in sharing and talking about the autumn season. And I just want to talk about how do we prepare for fall years. Is there no balm in Gilead? God is asking us that question. Is there no physician there? Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered? And I believe that there is a balm in Gilead. God has given us the spirit of prophecy and a health message that if we were to take heed, if we were to inculcate these principles into our lives, we would be far better off. And God was offended by the actions of King Ahaziah in his desire to get up. He sent to a dead God, ignoring the true and living God. And God, as a result, told him, you will not get up. So as we prepare for the fall years, you know, we spend our lives working. And one of the things that we want at the end of our working life is to be able to move into a nice house. We would like to be able to have a nice car. These are the things that we plan for. We would also like to have a nice pension at the end of our working life. You know, and so we will seek to make sure that these things are in place. I was quite surprised this week. I was on Facebook and came across somebody's posted this message, and this is not the name of the person. I just put that name there to in order to protect the individual's identity. But so it said Joe's next 7 years, 23, travel to Japan, 24, travel to the Maldives, 25, travel to Indonesia, travel 26, travel to New Zealand, 27, travel to France, 28, travel to Antarctica, 29, moving to Mars. But at no place did this individual say, by the grace of God, you know, by God's grace, are the things that I would like to do. And I just found it very, very strange because, you know, we can plan and we can have all the wonderful plans for our retirement, but it's only by the grace of God that we're able to do any of these things. And so what about your pension health? Sorry about the typing error there. What about your pension health? You know, so we are planning for the house, we plan for the car, we plan for the nice pension, but what about making sure that you plan for a good pension health? You may say, well, how do I do that? Or that's beyond me. No, it's not beyond you. Preparing for the 4 years is so important, and it is in your hands how prepare for those years. So Sonia this morning talked about gut health. Hippocrates, the father of modern medicine, based on his observation, said that all disease begins in the gut. So if that's the case, then we have to look after the gut. In fact, Sonia talked about 75% of our immune system being in the gut. And so the quality of the microbiome is determined by what you choose to eat. And, you know, the gut and the mind, there is that relationship. And this was an area where I did my dissertation in. And the mind is what determines what goes into the gut. So the mind and the will are key, because some folk will say, well, I can't do this, I can't do that, I like this and I like that. And so the mind is crucial in determining what it is that goes into the gut. And I want you to notice this quote from Dr. Bernard Jensen. He says, to take care of inherent weaknesses, we must take care of the whole person, but always the bowel first. If we take good care of the bowel, we can make the most of it and have better health as a result. The bowel is king. And if we take care of the king, he will take care of his kingdom, our body. But beloved, I want you to hear this, because he's saying that we must take care of the stomach. And the stomach is one of those things that we care about the least, because we are constantly eating. So, we get up in the morning, we have breakfast at, let's say, 8 o'clock. And by 10 o'clock, we're having tea and biscuits. By 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock, we're having lunch. And then by 3 o'clock, we're having tea and biscuits again. And then by 6 o'clock, we're having dinner. But then some people, even before they go to bed at 9 o'clock, they're having something to eat again. And this is a daily exercise. And the poor stomach is tired. It's crying out for rest. Because the spirit of prophecy tells us that we should not be taking in anything between meals. And so I'm saying that if you are preparing for those 4 years, if you're looking to enjoy your 4 years, then look after the gut. Make sure you're giving it plenty of rest. Make sure I'll come to that a little bit later on. But it's so important that you look after your stomach. The bowel is king. And very often the stomach is just overworked. It is tired because it's been abused, because we have no control. An underactive colon, where the process of elimination is too slow, will result in a diseased body. Dr. Paulian makes the following point. The speediest way to gain health is to stimulate the eliminating organs to eliminate poisonous substances and to avoid poisonous substances. So let me just say here, one of the most important things to do when you get sick is just to have a clear out, just get rid of all that toxic waste that is in the stomach by, you know, you can have senna, you can use Sagrada Cascara, you can use the salt cleanse, you know, so there are a range of things. There is prune juice, you know, there's a whole range of things that you can use to help you just cleanse, flush out that colon. Also, you know, as he talks about elimination there, elimination is the speediest way to regain your health. And that's one way. So if you are sick, it's good not to eat for a day or two and just take in liquids and allow the stomach to rest. This is really so important. But what we do is we run down to Ekron and we want to get some pills in order to pile in there. We might not even understand what's going on. We may not know what's going on, but doc, just give me a pill. Just give me something. You know, very often we don't even know what he's giving us. Or we run out and we buy something over the counter rather than allowing nature to play its role. And so I'm talking about preparing for the fall years, preparing for that time when you're later in life, and we need to make sure that we're planning for that time now. Impure conditions within the body are the primary cause of disease. Germs are the secondary cause. And so, you know, when Hippocrates says that all disease begins in the gut, he places the responsibility for illness on ourselves. We are the ones responsible, you know. And so when you fall sick, it's the body trying to tell you that you've done something wrong. There is something that you should not have done. And the body is trying to eliminate, you know. So when we are sick, whether you have diarrhea, whether you're vomiting, or whether you come out in bumps and lumps and so on, the body is trying to tell you that there are toxins inside that need to come out. And our immediate reaction is to go and buy some cream to put on the skin, to push it back in, give me something to stop the vomiting, give me something to stop the diarrhea. These are all natural reactions, because we want to get up. We've fallen and we want to get up. But we need to know what's going on. Why is it that this is taking place? And once you know why, you know the cause, then we can begin to deal with the symptoms. Listen to your gut. Taste is king. This is a Burger King advert. Listen to your gut. Taste is king. And so very often we are driven by taste. God has given us these wonderful taste buds. And of course, we want our food to taste good and look good. And we, you know, regardless of whether you are vegan, you're vegetarian, or you're a meat eater, we want good tasting food. That's natural. That's what God has given to us. But we should not allow taste to dictate our choices. And sadly, that is what happens. Taste does dictate. And so Ecclesiastes chapter 2 and verse 10, whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure, for my heart found no pleasure in all my toil. And this was a reward for all my toils. Here is Solomon saying, whatever my eyes desired, I just gave in. I kept my heart from no pleasure. Beloved, this is a recipe for disaster if you're planning for the fall years. You know, sometimes we say, well, you know, I've had such a hard week. I'm just going to reward myself with a KFC, or I'm going to reward myself with a nice piece of cake or whatever. I kept my heart from no pleasure, he says, and this was my reward for all my toil. And we can understand where Solomon is coming from. But this is a recipe for disaster, because number one, taste should not dictate our choices, and we should not reward ourselves with something that's going to damage the body. I'm talking about preparing for those 4 years. And it is so important that we begin to lay a foundation, lay a healthy foundation from now, so that when you come to those later years, you know, we're here on the farm and we get some young people who come to the farm and we find that they can't keep up with Roina and myself. We're in our 60s. They can't keep up. They cannot work hard. You know, they're not laying a proper foundation. People love to eat unhealthy food. These are barbecue foods. These are fried foods. And these are just introducing free radicals into the body, which is damaging your cells. Barbecue foods are some of the worst foods that you can eat. A 2-pound steak that has been barbecued is the equivalent of smoking 600 cigarettes because of the benzopyrene that's coming from the smoke. And so barbecue foods should be avoided, you know, and so we should not allow taste to dictate our choices. These are, you know, these drinks come to us with saccharin. They come with all kind of false sweeteners. The drink that God has made for us is water. And I have to admit that here on the farm, our primary drink is water. And we have fruit juices that we make ourselves. So God has blessed us with a lot of grapes. And so we've made grape juice. We're just coming into the orange season where we'll be preserving orange juices from orange. There is no chemicals, no sugars, no preservatives whatsoever, just natural stuff. So this is what God intended for us. And if you are seeking to lay a good foundation for those 4 years, these are the foods that you should be giving up. You know, while you have health now, build on it, beloved. Build on it. Put something away in the bank. Just as you're banking away, you're putting away for those pension. I want a nice pension. I'd like to have a home. I'd like to have a nice car. What about your pension health? Lay the foundation now. And so fried foods, or the refined rice, refined flours, foods that's highly saturated. We need to move away from those foods. We are talking about laying a foundation for those 4 years that are to come. Tin foods, anything that is processed here. Folk, look at this page, and there's only a couple of good things here, the bananas and your fruits. We need to move away from processed foods. And I'm not saying that you can't have some chips once in a while or a biscuit once in a while, you know, but this should not be your normal daily fare, because it is nutritionally compromised. And certainly the drinks there, we should not be touching them at all. No wonder we see so much sickness around us, because people are not following the laws of health. From the book, Counsels on Diets and Foods, I advise you to make your diet abstemious. Be sure that as a rational Christian sentinel, you guard the door to your stomach, allowing nothing to pass your lips that will be an enemy to your health and life. God holds you responsible to obey the light he has given you on health reform. So somebody has said that every time we sit down at the dining table, you're either building your health or you're destroying your health. And remember that the great controversy between good and evil began at the dining table. It began at the dining table, and it continues today at the dining table. And it all comes down to your ability to say, no, I will not do that. Notice, I advise you to make your diet abstemious, you know? And so we have to be prepared for those good choices. Nature bears abuse as long as she can without resisting. Then she arouses and makes a mighty effort to rid herself of the encumbrances and evil treatment that she has suffered. And so then comes the headache, chills, fevers, nervousness, paralysis, and other evils too numerous to mention. That is the body trying to heal.
Seem to have a bad connection.
Can you hear me? Hopefully I'm back. This is the body trying to heal itself when we get sick. You find that kind of counterintuitive. I'm sick. You're saying, I need to get better. Give me something, doc. Give me something to fix me up. But this is the body trying to heal itself. And you just need to be willing to work with your body, you know. So then comes headache, chills, fevers, nervousness, paralysis, and other evils too numerous to mention. A wrong course of eating or drinking destroys health and with it the sweetness of life. Oh, how many times have you purchased what you called a good meal at the expense of a fevered system, loss of appetite, loss of sleep, inability to enjoy food, a sleepless night, hours of suffering, all for a meal in which taste was gratified. That sounds like Solomon, doesn't it? You know, whatever my eyes wanted, I gave in to. But I'm talking about laying a foundation for those 4 years. And then, you know, recently I noticed that there's a lot of people who are having hip and knee replacements, and this comes in those 4 years. It continues to increase with more than 138,500 surgeries and estimated inflation cost of over 1.4 billion a year. Interest rates vary across the country, ranging from 148 per 100,000 population for Quebec to 267 per 100,000 population for Yukon. For knee replacements, the age standardized rates range from 165 per 1,000 population for Quebec to 296 per 100,000 population for Saskatchewan. So most patients were aged 65 or older. For hip replacements, the most common age group was 75 years and older. For knee replacements, it was 65 to 74 years old. And so here's this lady smiling broadly. Why would you do that when you are about to have your normal hip replaced or your knee replaced? That's because people are in a lot of pain. More than half of patients were women, 57.9%. Among women having a hip replacement, 43% were older than 75. Among men having a hip replacement, 30% were in this age group. And so there are many individuals who are having these operations, and sometimes people in their early 60s. I'm talking about protecting yourself in those 4 years, and it needs to be done now. The most common diagnosis for primary hip and knee replacement was osteoarthritis at 72.5% and 99.4% respectively. And so countries with the highest rates of hip and knee surgeries are to be found in the developed world, where we consume a high protein and highly processed food diet. You know, here on the farm, we have lots of people who come through to help us do various tasks. And I've had two individuals come and they say, Sam, I need protein. I cannot function without protein. And so what they're really saying is that this vegan lifestyle, this vegan diet cannot sustain me. Give me protein. And it really is a false way of thinking. High protein diet for bodybuilders. Bodybuilders believe that they need to have a high protein diet, meats, poultry and fish, sirloin steak, ground beef, pork tenderloin, venison, chicken breast, salmon, tilapia and cod, dairy, yogurt, cottage cheese, low-fat milk and cheese, grains, bread, cereal, crackers, oatmeal, quinoa, popcorn and rice. You know, so these people feel that unless I have a high protein diet, I cannot bulk up. I'm not getting all the things that I need. But I want you to listen to this. Almost all, 98% calcium in the body is stored in the bones, and the body uses the bones as a reservoir. Sonia talked about this morning, as a reservoir for and source of calcium to maintain calcium homeostasis. More than 99% of calcium in the body is in the form of calcium hydroxyapatite, an inorganic matrix of calcium and phosphate that is stored in the bones and in the teeth. And unlike teeth, bone undergoes continuous remodeling with constant reabsorption and deposition of calcium into new bone. Bone modeling is required to change bone size during growth, repair damage, maintain serum calcium levels, and provide a source of other minerals. And the reason I'm telling you this is that you need to look after your bones. And so one of the things they tell us is that you need to make sure that you're drinking a lot of milk. Others fuels. And here is the other one, you know, if you're going to have good bones, then you need to be drinking milk as a high calcium content. 60 to 80% of it is not absorbed through the human intestine. In general, humans absorb as much or more of the calcium in plant products than they do from milk. This is Dr. Neil Nedley from his book, Proof Positive. And so eating a lot of green vegetables, eating nuts and seeds, you will get more in terms of calcium content from those things than from milk. Notice this, the real villain for poor bone health is not inadequate consumption of calcium, but rather an excess intake of what? Protein. And so people come to me and they're saying, we need protein, we need more protein. I've even had people here on the farm who've come, Adventists, who've come and said, well, how do we get our protein? And they've left the farm and gone to a fish restaurant or gone to buy meat because they're being poor things, they're being deprived of protein. Beloved, I'm talking about laying a foundation for the 4 years. A study was conducted that found that Eskimos consume 2,500 milligrams of calcium per day and yet suffered greatly from osteoporosis. I want you to notice this, Dr. Neil Nedley, quoting the executive director of Soy Nutrition. He says, when people eat several servings of grains, beans, and vegetables throughout the day and get enough calories, it is virtually impossible to be deficient in protein. And so if you are eating a well-rounded diet, and Sonia again alluded to this this morning in the colors, if you're eating a range of fruits and vegetables and nuts, then you will be okay. A high protein diet robs the body of calcium. And so in those 4 years, people are having hip replacements, they're having knee replacements because they have not laid a good foundation in the things that they're eating on a daily basis. And I know that this is the food that some of us love, right? This is rice and peas and chicken or whatever. You know, these are not healthy foods. These are not good foods. You know, you may having cream cakes with custard and milk and eggs. We need to move away from these things. If you want to lay a healthy foundation for later on in those 4 years, then we really need to be taking a good look at our diet, look at what it is that we're eating now. The eggs, look at that on the right. You've got eggs and beef there with chips, and this is looking good. And these are the foods that people love to eat. And I must confess, when I was growing up as a child and we had chips and egg, there was a day, one day a week, when my mom would give us eggs and fried dumplings and chips, and wonderful. You know, those are the things that we love to eat, but not laying the proper foundation. So if all disease begins in the stomach, then the mind is the key that unlocks the door, because the mind is the gateway. Ellen White says that 90% of all disease begins in the mind. You know, and so when you tell yourself, I can't drink water without a little juice in it, or I must put some cordial in it, I can't eat vegetables, you know, it makes me sick, I can't eat fruits, and so on. We are laying the foundation for sickness. And so these are the foods. As you prepare for those 4 years, a good amount of raw fruits and vegetables is what you should be eating. We choose the kind of nutrition that goes in. We're the ones who determine what the quality of that microbiome is going to be like, which will enhance the quality of your health. We choose the time when that food goes in. We choose the type of food that goes in. Here are some cruciferous vegetables. These are very good. Cabbages, broccoli, cauliflower. These are good foods. Kale, parsnips. As I come towards closing, I want to do red bean stew. We're familiar with it. Good chickpea stew. These are some of my favorite foods. Lentils. Fruits and vegetables, nuts. These are all the things that God intended that we should be eating. And when you eat these things, you cannot go wrong, beloved. You know, certainly if you're going to over curry them up and do all kinds of things with them, but keeping it simple, keeping it tasty, keeping it nice. This is wholesome, nutritious food, and it is not processed. This is the most important thing. And always begin your meal with a good plate of salad. You know, good plate of salad. Always begin your meal so that you're getting your raw. And look at these, your seeds. Sonia gave a prescription, you know, and she told you some of the things that you need to have in your emergency cabinet. And I want to add and say, these are the things that you should have in your kitchen cabinet. Linseed or flax seed. You should have sunflower seeds, almonds, pumpkin seeds, all these nuts, flax seed. We've got sesame seeds, pumpkin seeds, walnuts, chia seeds. You should be having all of these seeds in your kitchen cabinet. These are your omega-3 fats. These, you've got your calcium, you've got minerals. All of these things should form a part of your daily diet. As you seek to lay a firm foundation for those 4 years. Look at this salad. Isn't it wonderful? Having a variety of salads will make sure. And so, beloved, we will fall down, but it is how you seek to get up that really matters. Ahaziah fell through the lattice of his upper room in Samaria, and he sought to get up by using the wrong protocol, and it resulted in the loss of his life. We are seeking to lay a strong foundation now for those 4 years so that we can enjoy those years, enjoy a quality of health. The responsibility for taking drugs is ours, not the doctor. So you go to the doctor and you can explain to the doctor what your problem is. But after that, what you do, it's up to you. We are told that we are not excusable if through ignorance we destroy God's building by taking into our stomachs poisonous substances under a variety of names we do not understand. It is our duty to refuse all such prescriptions. So the Apostle Paul challenges us. He says, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. So 1 Corinthians 6:24, you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are God's. And so, beloved, as I close, using drugs, it is contrary to the light that the Lord has been pleased to give. The drugging business has done more harm to our world and has killed more than it has helped. And notice the food that God has given to us. God said, see, I have given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed to you, it shall be for food. As I close, beloved, as we seek to get up from our falls, is there no balm in Gilead? I want to say to you, yes, there is a balm in Gilead. Is there no physician there? Yes, God has given us a wealth of information that will help us to navigate our way into and out of and beyond those 4 years. God asks the question, why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered? That's because we have not embraced the health message that God has given to us. We fall down, but we get up. By the grace of God, we will get up and we will use the right protocols. We will use the right agencies as we seek to get up and come into wellness. The sad lesson from Isaiah was that he chose the wrong protocol, but God wants us to make sure that we choose the right protocol, that we make sure that we prepare, we lay a strong foundation for those years. We only have one health, and we need to make sure that we look after that one health that God has given to us, and that we can move into those 4 years. And the 4 years are wonderful years. There are years when we can give glory to God by showing others just how healthy and well we are. And may God bless you as you seek to prepare for those 4 years that are coming. And may God bless you today. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Davis. Thank you so much for the message today. Thank you for everyone who's presented. It's amazing how things have come together from a topic like this. I'm like, how can we bring this all into a health subject so that we can all benefit from it? But there are so many lessons that have gone right through the theme of the day. And, you know, one of the things that struck me is like, everybody falls down. We all fall. You know that I've had some major falls. I even had one the other day, and I've had some that really have damaged me. And it's not about how we fall, but it's about how we get up. And I wish I had time to share my own testimony with that, because it's so in tune with what we've talked about today. But you know, when we listen to health messages like this, you know, we all take it away very as a very individual thing, which it is. But I just want to put it all together collectively for us as a church, as a small church here in Richmond. We have so much to do together. We can grow together. And you know, today one of the themes that came out was how important the gut is for us, you know, and what comes out of the gut. And another thing we talked about was inflammation and how inflammation is so detrimental to the body. I want to ask us a question in our group together. How does inflammation produce and show itself in our church family? You know, what are some of the hazard signs that we have in our group that trip us up and make us fall over? What's some of the clutter that we have here in our church in Richmond that make us trip and fall and lose our balance? These are all things that we talked about today, that Sonia spoke about, and Shira and David and Sam when he spoke to us. And how can we build a healthy spiritual immune system here in Richmond Church? One that will take us through not just this fall season, but that will take us through the winter season.
And that takes us through into the spring. And you know, sometimes when we get to summer, it all looks good. But if our immune system is not strong, come fall again, we're struggling. And we have, that's a whole theme that came through today, that we build in for fall in our physical age. In, as we age, we're building for that. But in our spiritual language, how can we build for a healthy fall season? All the struggles that come in our small family, let us work together and see how we can bring our family together so that we can be strong. So what will a healthy family look like for us, Richmond? How are we going to know when we're up? And when we have strong immune systems, and that we make the right decisions for a group. And as we move forward into this next season of our life, of our spiritual journey as a family, may God bring us together so that when we fall, we can get back up stronger and better than ever before. And the closing scripture that was given was, is there a balm in Gilead? Is there no balm in Gilead? But yes, there is a balm in Gilead. And that's going to be our closing song for today. Let's listen to the words of this song and join in as we sing, there is a balm in Gilead to heal us of all our sicknesses, our inflammations, our poor immune systems, all our breakages, all the things that really leave us feeling weak. But there is a balm in Gilead to soothe our sin sick souls. So let's sing that song as we close.
There is a balm in Thank you.
Are you praying, Pastor?
Yes, let's bow his head and pray. Father in heaven, we just want to thank you that there is indeed a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. Oh, Lord God, you know that we fall often. We fall because of our choices. We fall because we make mistakes and our desire is to get up. But we want to thank you that there is that balm, there is that provision that you have given to us. And the truth, Father, like Ahaziah, we go and we choose the wrong protocols. We go down to Ekron and we take poisonous drugs because we feel that it's quicker. We have conditioned ourselves into believing that these are more effective. But God, we know that these are just poisonous drugs, and we have seen how many have lost their lives because they have become addicted to these substances. But we want to thank you for your word. We thank you that that word that comes to us through the pen of inspiration. We have good nutrition. We have exercise. We have water. We have sunshine. We have fresh air. We have the opportunity to make good choices. And then we have rest and trust in God. And so, Lord God, we pray that you'll help us, that we will use these natural remedies and we will move away from the poisonous substances that cause so much damage. Father, just want to pray for those on this platform who may be on medication. We are not encouraging them to give up their medication without getting or seeking good advice so that they can know how they ought to navigate and how to plan for those fall years. There are individuals who are living within the fall right now. We pray that you help them to make wise choices. We pray, Father, that even if the foundation was not laid, it's still not too late for them to begin to do better. We thank you for your word. Thank you that there is indeed a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. God, as we seek to rise up from our beds of affliction, may we take hold of the balm that you have given to every one of us. And may your will, Father, be done in our lives. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.